50 years ago was the pilgrimage to Woodstock, and we have joined on Tuesday, June 18th at 7 o'clock by John Kane, who's going to talk about his new book and some never-seen-before photographs all about the Pilgrims of Woodstock in a 50-year retrospective. I'm talking today with John. John, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me, Clayton. I appreciate it.
I'm really excited that you're going to be coming here to Quincy to share these photographs and to talk about your book, which is coming out this summer.
Yes.
Yeah. So did you take these photographs, or how did you acquire them?
certainly not. I'm a Gen Xer, and yeah. I get that look a lot from the baby boomer demographic, like, you wrote a book about Woodstock? Were you even there? How I came upon writing this book was through another book that's coming out in late 2019 called The Last Seat in the House, The Story of Hanley Sound. And the subject of that book is a gentleman by the name of Bill Hanley from Medford, Massachusetts. He was the sound engineer of Woodstock. About nine small chapters of that book are dedicated to his efforts and his crew's efforts in deploying sound reinforcement at the Woodstock Festival. Through that effort and writing and researching that project, I've become somewhat of a Woodstock scholar, in basically interviewing every living individual who was part of the, had some part in the production of that festival in relation to Bill Hanley. And that also includes Woodstock attendees, the Living Woodstock Ventures production staff or producers of the festival, and others that were at the Fillmore East venue, which migrated over from that venue to Woodstock to help facilitate that iconic festival. So that book came out of a doctoral dissertation in 2014, and kind of just really summarize, from 2015 to 2017, I rewrote that dissertation into a book, which got picked up by the University Press of Mississippi. And a long line of rejection letters from my proposals from that book, which is normal, I suspect, I hope.
I think that's absolutely normal. Every author I've ever talked to, if you can't take rejection, you should not be in the business. Yeah.
I know. The University Press of Indiana said, hey, we really like what you wrote about Bill Hanley and Woodstock. The 50th is coming up. Would you be interested in writing a book for a trade audience, a broader audience, less scholarly, but more for, I don't even like to say average reader, but just less of a scholarly approach.
More accessible, we'll call it.
More accessible, yeah. Shorter, of course. I mean, the Hanley book's about 600 pages.
And more pictures, I hope.
Yeah. Well, yes, of course. so I said, yes, I actually have, in my head, I said, yes, I have this collection, this wonderful collection of photographs that I own, that I acquired from an estate of a photographer named, Brooklyn-based photographer named Richard F. Belak. Belak has since deceased, 2015. His estate went up with no heirs. Belak had no brothers, sisters, cousins, no family, and it sat for a while. And many people in the Woodstock community who are researchers, historians like myself, were kind of eyeing this collection out, and I was fortunate enough to acquire it. And I was in those pictures. I was looking for Hanley. Really, I was looking for sound images of the sound towers, images of the production crew. Mm-hmm. So I basically just had it, negatives and all. And I thought, well, what about a book about? Since I have all this access to these wonderful interviews and people, a book about just the audience experience, where it is the 50th. And many people have said the real performers were not the musicians on the stage, but really the performance by the audience. You know, how the audience got along and how they kind of worked together to make that weekend so special.
I can't believe. So I was just looking at the description. There were 400,000 people. I mean, Woodstock looms large in the popular kind of in popular culture. Everybody knows of it. But to think that, was it really that many people?
Well, you have to put this all into perspective. Mass gatherings were not uncommon before and after Woodstock. Beginning with Monterey Pop in 1967, popular music as the quality of production equipment got better, popular music grew. Radio, FM radio was on the rise, and there you have it. And more of that counterculture was meeting in larger groups at these multi-day, multi-performance events. And I firmly believe it just grew and grew and grew, and it spilled over at Woodstock. But that summer, the July 4th of July weekend of that summer, 1969, there was another festival, the Atlanta Pop Festival, and mm-hmm. I believe it was in Byron, Georgia. And that was about 200,000 people. They say more, but there's really no way to calculate that many.
It's really hard to count that many people.
But 400,000, I think, is fairly accurate. Max Yazgers, he was one of the famed farmer of of Woodstock that leased the land to Woodstock Ventures. He was the largest farmer, landowner in that area in mm-hmm. Sullivan County. 600 acres. So, you know, when you look at photos, the crowd was really sprawling. So I believe an accurate number is about 400,000, maybe 450,000. They weren't expecting much, but yeah.
How does that compare with festivals today? I mean, if you think of Boston Calling or Bonnaroo or, you know, Coachella that just happened, you know how many people go to those?
Well, I think less, and I think there are... The infrastructure, there's now a formal, systematic infrastructure in place now with festivals. You know, there are checkpoints, there are tickets, there are ticket gates, there are fences, there are police. You know, all these things are, and these are, the festivals of today are truly modeled after Woodstock, or what Woodstock should have been. And Woodstock in many ways was chaotic. It was... There was none of that, you know. Yeah. So you just had people spilling in with no control, and that's the miracle, and that's the myth, is that amid all of the chaos, you had harmony, and that mm-hmm. I think is the lore, the myth and lore of Woodstock.
Well, so you must have gotten, and with all these photographs, there must be an incredible, and all the conversations you've had. There must be just an incredible range of stories that you've heard with that many people and all the people that you've talked to. I wonder if you might share a couple, like a little bit, little samples to kind of tease people so they can, you know, kind of know, you know.
Sure. Well, you know, in my lecture, I talk about the construct of the book. I didn't want it to be, and I was firm about this with the publisher, that I didn't want it to be another, because when you look on Amazon or any other book outlet, there are lots of books about Woodstock, a lot of books with photographs, and, you know, what sets Pilgrims of Woodstock apart.
Yeah.
I was strong about keeping the book less about the hippie, drippy, acid trippy kind of approach, psychedelic, tie-dye, and more of a respectful, classic approach.
You weren't trying to exoticize it. You were trying to just say, all right, these are regular people that were, you know, just like you and me, who were interested in seeing some music and hanging out with their friends.
That, and when you look at the photos, and when you hear people talk about Woodstock now, it's a celebratory thing.
Yeah.
But when you look at the photos, most of the individuals look pretty miserable. I mean, they're not entirely happy. They're in the mud. It's really stinky. You know, there's lack of resources, food, water.
It was not comfortable. Yeah.
It was. It was a feat to get through that weekend, and it's on the faces and on the sleeves of this youth culture of the day. So in my approach, it was really important for me to interview a cross-section of, and a diverse cross-section, I should say, of attendees. Women. I wanted to hear from women and what it was like to be a woman. And at the height or the beginning of the women's liberation movement, I wanted to hear from a Vietnam veteran, someone who was right out from the war. I wanted their perspective because Woodstock wasn't, many will say Woodstock was a political event, but it really wasn't that much. When you watch the movie, and you see the crowd, there wasn't too much. It wasn't like a demonstration, an anti-war demonstration. It was a celebration of music and art. So it was important for me to hear what a veteran fresh from the Vietnam War would have saw or felt. Those who were from other parts of the world, that was really difficult. I managed to interview someone from Canada, the West Coast, was a much different scene. They were going through a different, kind of folk rock, psychedelic scene. What was it like to come to the East Coast and feel that kind of cultural difference? And yeah, so and of course, Hispanic, Black representation, very important for me to talk to those individuals as well. I think I did a pretty good job. If I had more time, I would have interviewed 50. I interviewed 40 and then cherry-picked the best, so I interviewed about 30 individuals. So, stories. In the book, I have the story of the couple that are on the cover of the Woodstock album, the Urquhartines, and they talk about how they were local people, and how they heard about the festival and how they ventured in and happened upon getting the photograph on the album. It's a really interesting story. Mm. I interviewed, have you ever seen the movie before?
I have, or at least I've seen snippets. I don't know if I've sat through the whole thing.
There was a guy named Wayne Rogers, and a lot of people back then had nicknames. His nickname was Turkey.
Okay.
And I forget why, but because he looked... He kind of looks like a turkey.
Okay.
That's what he would say. He's in the movie, the Woodstock, the Academy Award-winning documentary, Woodstock, by Michael Wadley. He is in the film, and he's the gentleman that comes out of the porta stand with a hash pipe.
Okay.
And, when he comes out of that porta stand, he's interviewed, and it's very brief. He gives the whole backstory as to why he was in the porta stand. I just found that extremely interesting. I was like, well, this... uncovered information, because so much has been written about Woodstock. Why were you in the Portisan? Well, he was in the Portisan with six other individuals, if you can imagine, trying to get out of the wind to light a hash pipe. And then he comes out first, and then he says it was Martin Scorsese who was interviewing him. So it's just like, that's beautiful, when you uncover that. Hmm. I think one other interview that really stands out for me is the Vietnam veteran who was in the Tet Offensive. He entered Vietnam during the Tet Offensive, which was, I believe, in 67 or 68. Mm-hmm. And, it was a difficult interview because he was crying during mm-hmm. my interview with him. So I said, well, listen, we don't have to do this. We could just stop.
Yeah.
And he said he felt strongly that he said, no, this interview needs to be done, and I want it in the book. So it was my, my responsibility at that point to tell his story and put that story in the book. So when you read Pilgrims of Woodstock, you are immersed in these individuals' experiences only at the festival. We learn only of their first name, only of their age, and we stop where they leave. We don't learn about them becoming stockbrokers or parents and all that. It was my effort to create a time capsule, because Belak's images are different than you will not find my individuals interviewed in the Belak images. Maybe with a magnifying glass somewhere. But how do you merge those two? So when I was looking at the Belak images, I pulled themes and questions from those, mm-hmm. and that drove the content, the inquiry on how I would interview these attendees. And by doing that, everything just came together. So you just have this beautiful bubble, time capsule, I should say, which is just all encapsulating. It's beautiful, yeah.
Well, that is really... I'm really looking forward to seeing the book. I'm really excited to having you here.
Thanks.
It sounds like there's going to be a lot for people who maybe were alive at the time of Woodstock, but also a lot for people who are interested in framing it and looking at how it relates to our existence today and new ways of looking at it. People obviously can see... the movie's been out for a long time.
Sure.
It's been part of our popular... kind of the mythology around the 60s, and it has been used to symbolize so much. But I'm really excited to hear these stories. I think hopefully some people will even be inspired to go and look at a little bit deeper and look at some of your more historic pieces and get some deeper analysis. So I think, and it couldn't be more timely to be doing it here when there's a clash of cultures that's happening, has been happening since. There's been many, I think, cultural revolutions that, some people say sparked or were at a head there, but we are not out of the woods yet, so.
No, definitely not. I mean, there's a lot mirroring, today. What was happening then is mirrored now, and, that identification and those connections can be made very easily. Most that have been in my audience are baby boomers. Some, I hope in that audience or wherever I give this presentation that they let me know early on that they were at Woodstock. And I want those people to be part of the lecture, the presentation, because I was not at Woodstock. You know, they were there. They've had that experience, you know. So that only it enriches the presentation and lecture. So in no way, shape, or form do I ever try to take full ownership. I'm just a vehicle, really, to the story.
Well, that's great. Thank you, John.
Yeah, sure.
Please, come out and join us and learn, revisit, learn about it for the first time, dive deeper into Woodstock, a 50-year retrospective, happening again on Tuesday, June 18th, starting at 7 o'clock. I look forward to seeing you there.